So I am going to talk about feminism in the Philippines. And you know, this is usually a 1 hour and a half talk, but I have only 30 minutes, so I cannot explain thoroughly each one, each of the slides. So you can just ask me during the question and answer period. I would like to begin with the historical excursus. In many countries, they say that the coming of the Spaniards to their places put up the status of women. It is not so in the Philippines. It's the opposite. Because before the Spaniards came, we were an egalitarian society. It's not a matriarchal society because that includes inheritance, etc. It is egalitarian, which I find better than matriarchal, no? And what does that mean? That the boys and the girls are really treated equally. And the reason for that is because my four parents did not have a concept of virginity. And because they have no concept of virginity, they did not make any, it is not as if the daughter is more vulnerable than the boy. Because later on, I will show you how that will domesticate the Filipino women. And so they were equal in everything. They were equal in inheritance. They are equal in housework. They can also engage in business with the Chinese when they come. So economically, politically, they can be the head of the barangay or the smallest unit of political unit. So economically, politically, socially, they were equal with the men. But one important thing is that in the religious field, they are a little bit above because we have what we call the babaylan, that is this medium between the spirit world and the world of the humans. And it's only women who can be babaylan, which is very much the opposite now. I mean, at least in the Catholic Church, only men can be priests. But at that time, only women can be babaylans, no? So in that case, they are really an important part of society. Okay. And later on, when the Spaniards came, they were very worried about the women. This is the way they thought. Mostly the friars, they would say, oh, how can these women go to heaven? Because they are so free. You know, at that time there was no prostitution, there was not much rape, because boys and girls or teenage or what they call men and women, they could actually talk together, and if they like each other, they could have relationship with one another. So the thing is, why will you pay somebody when you can coax her to have a relationship with you? So it's very ironic that if the Spaniards came, they are the ones who put up the first prostitution house. And it is very ironic too, because it was in a college. One half of the college was for the orphans for education. And one half is for the employees of the king, which means to say these are prostitutes who have to serve the Spanish soldiers because the Spanish soldiers came, of course, with colonization, no? So this was the before the Spaniards came and after the Spaniards came, because Spain at that time was a very patriarchal society. The women cannot go out without companion. They cannot be courted without the mother present. So all those patriarchal values and patriarchal structures were introduced by the friars and the Spaniards in the Philippines, and they even brought in manuals, you know, manuals how to educate your daughters. And so they really actually domesticated. That's what I call domestication of, they called mujer indígena, indigenous women. So I just wanted to make that as an introduction, because later our feminism is inspired by that, no? Because sometimes people say, oh, the feminism in Asia, they are just copying the feminism of the West. I beg to disagree. We have a legacy of equality, and that is what is inspiring us to take back that equality and even go beyond, no? So I wanted to say that. Now, after some time, of course, all the women's issues came forward. As soon as the patriarchal values and structures were introduced into the country, so then you have inequality in the house, inequality in society, violence against women, what they call this commercialization of women, etc., etc. So all these women's issues began to permeate the whole of society in the Philippines. Now, there were some early women's movement, but mostly this early women's movement about in this 18th century, they were mostly organizations, charitable organizations for the poor, etc. And usually they were like a counterpart of a man's organization. So they are still under the men. One exception is the suffragette movement in the 1920s, when women really said that we have to have the same voting rights as the men. And I would say this is one of the first political movement of women in the Philippines, although they did not yet have a feminist analysis of women oppression, but at least they were for the political empowerment of women. Okay, afterward, the second phase, now this is already about the 60s, no? It was not until the late 60s that the widening gap between the rich and the poor, the intensifying economic distress and political instability gave rise to a national liberation movement in the Philippines. The first phase being known as the first quarter storm. Now, this is important because it will also influence the kind of feminism we have, no? I remember that because in the 70s, well, I am much older than all of you, so I am considered one of the pioneers of the women's movement in the Philippines. And we really saw to it that the feminism in the Philippines is an essential part of our national liberation movement. In other words, we cannot think of a comprehensive transformation of society if one half of the population are being oppressed or exploited by the other half. So it became very essential that if we want to have a truly comprehensively liberated society, we have to include the women's issue in any national liberation movement. So we influenced the national liberation movement to have, instead of a 10-point program, they have a 12-point program because they then included the equality of women, no? So it is very important that that is said. And secondly, we were also very aware of the different notions that the feminism is just bra burning and it is what they call this women who will dominate the men, etc. So what we are saying there is that the men are also victims of socialization. There is not a boy who was born a macho, you know, that is learned. And therefore, even though definitely the socialization of society, the gender socialization of society, definitely benefits the men, of course, but they are still also victims of socialization. And therefore, we cannot consider them our enemies. We consider them prospective allies or something. And then, but our main enemy and our focus of our struggle is against patriarchy, both as a concept and as a structure and the way it is being practiced in society. No? So, and also, now I have to say this, we also learned from the Western feminist movement, of course. I have to give credit where credit is due in their feminist analysis. So that is where we acknowledge that we were also we also learned from the feminist movement in the West, so that our women's movement had a clear feminist perspective. Now, but I have to explain what is the meaning of feminism to us. But before that, I have to say a little bit about the woman question. No? For us, the woman, there is a woman question, definitely. No, and that woman question is defined as the fact, and it's not a theory, it's a fact that there is discrimination, subordination, oppression, and exploitation of women as women. And it cuts across class, race, religion, nationality. it has an ideological, that is the patriarchy, and structural aspect, and it is a global problem. That is for us the woman question. Now, what is then feminism? Well, first, it manifests itself first in inequality, subordination, and discrimination of women, both in the home and society. And of course, the terrible manifestation of this is the violence against women and children. You know, the sexual harassment, trafficking, the rape, incest, battery. And of course, there is now the commodification of women and media. And you are journalists, and you know that the recent struggle is the cybercrime. You know, the recent stage of exploitation, especially of children, is cybercrime. I belong to the cyber guardians here, which is fighting against this cybercrime. And because it is so terrible that parents are the pimps, no? So we are fighting against this. And you know, I'm so ashamed to say, but the Philippines is considered considered the hub of this sexual violence against children through the media. No? That's why we are fighting it very much, because it is so shameful that the Philippines, who is the only Christian country in the Far East, it is the hub, it is the center of child cyber prostitution and cyber bullying. Okay, so you have the commodification of women in media, and I really like the talk. And then, of course, we have prostitution, local and global. You have the mail order brides before. And of course, the overseas contract workers are not only rape and all that, but also in work, no? How they are exploited as maids, as nannies in first world. So this woman question, these are the manifestations in the Philippines. And so what is our definition of feminism? It's very easy. There are two questions that we ask. Number one, are you aware of the woman question? And in the way I explained it. Number two, if you are aware of the woman question, are you willing to commit yourself to help in changing the situation? Just that. So if your answer is yes to one and two, then you are a feminist, whether you are a woman, a man, LGBTQ, whatever. That is our basic definition of feminism. And of course, there are many kinds of feminism. There's Marxist feminism, socialist feminism, et cetera, et cetera. Now, all those are, for me, peripheral, all what they are doing. Then, for me, the main question is, are you aware of the woman question? Are you committed to changing the situation? That is the way we understood, or we understand, feminism in the Philippines. And I just said this already, that we are not copying the feminism of the West. Because as I said, although the mothers were actually captive, no, they were really brainwashed by the priors. But I always say the Filipino woman, they had a subversive memory of their equality. It's subversive because that is the one that will subvert this whole sexism afterwards. So we have a subversive memory of our equality before the Spanish times. And of course, we acknowledge what we learned from the Western feminists. Now, another phenomenon in the Philippines is that most, if not all, Filipino feminists were first political activists before they became feminists. I don't know if anyone was a feminist first then become political activist. No, we were all political activists first. And for me, that is a very good beginning, because then you are at once grounded socially. It is not just relationship between men and women. No, it's not just. It is the whole aspect of transformation of society. So I am glad that, and of course, we learned a lot from our political activism in the strategizing and so forth when we founded the women's movement. No, so again, as I said, we made sure that we are not anti-men. They declared that men are not the enemy, but because they are victims of socialization. And therefore, every International Women's Day, we allow the men to accompany us in our march. We always have a march. But we tell them, don't go to the front, you go to the side at the back. But the women has to be, they have to be the one to bring the banners and all that. We do not prohibit them from going with us, but they have, they will not take the principal role. Okay. So GABRIELA is the largest and most militant women's organization in the Philippines. That's Philippines today, no? I have to tell you, it started from Women's Resource Center. Two of us started that Women's Resource Center, which was mainly research, publication, and conscientization work. And then in the 1980s, when Ninoy Aquino was assassinated, there sprouted a lot of women's organization in the Philippines. So what we did in 1984 was to have a kind of seminar or a conference, which was done in my school in St. Scholastica's College, no? And in that congress or whatever you want to call it, the women's organization made a resolution to establish an umbrella organization, multi-sectoral and rainbow in color. And therefore, the ones who actually established GABRIELA, it's not one or two persons, but it is the consensus of women's organization that came in the Congress of Women in 1984. And I became chairperson of this organization for 18 years, from 1986 to 2004. But there were two chairpersons before me. And it grew to be 250 women's organization and about 50,000 women members coming from the urban poor. It's called the Samakana, women peasants, the Amihan, the women workers, they call themselves KMK. And then there is also a National Organization of Women Religious of the Philippines. And then, of course, there's a GABRIELA Youth and there's GABRIELA Professionals. Now, of course, later on, there will be a little, what they call that, ideological difference, because the first chairperson, they come from the elite. And so during the election after Marcos, you know, when after the EDSA, or during the EDSA, I'm sure you have heard of that EDSA, that bloodless revolution that we made against Marcos, the women peasants, etc., they wanted to boycott. But the executive committee, because they are more elite women, they did not want. But the thing is, the peasants and the workers, they went out into boycott. So they resigned, the executive committee resigned. And that is when I was asked to, they nominated me as chairperson, no? So anyway, now in the middle of that, not in the middle, but maybe about 10 to 20 years, some GABRIELA people formed the GABRIELA party list. In other words, it is you have to distinguish between the people's organization, GABRIELA, and the political party, which is called the GABRIELA party list. And it's good that they formed this, because now they have representatives in Congress. They're able to do some political work too. Now, just some pictures for you to see the Amihan, and this one is about the agrarian reform, etc. These are the workers, the urban poor, and so forth. And of course, GABRIELA, etc. Now, if you will look at this picture, this is my school. And this school, every February 14, we have the 1 billion rising. I'm sure you have that too in Malaysia, no? Where you dance, and it is against violence against women. And in my school, all of us, so you can see all the students, the nuns, the administrator, etc., we dance the 1 billion rising. Okay, so you have nuns there. Now, this is me when I was still 50 pounds ago, I say like this, because I was still very thin at the time. So all about this one. So what did we learn in the strategies that is used by the women's movement in the Philippines? Organization. We realized that you have no power if you are not organized. So that's why we formed organization, because it's only organization that gives you power. The second is, but it's not enough to have an organization. You have to mobilize people, because some organizations, they begin with electing the officers and then making an oath of office, and nothing happens during the year, and at the end they will do election. No, that is the death of the organization. What we realize is that you have to mobilize your people when there is an issue. And that's why we really did that. And that's why we saved some people. For example, Sara Balabagan Flor Contemplation, they were condemned to death. They were OFW, you know, what they call this, workers overseas, because they have that Sara Balabagan happens to kill her employer who was trying to rape her. So they gave her a death penalty and so forth and so on. So we saved a lot of women, and we convicted American soldiers in the Philippines who raped Filipino women because of the mobilization and the cooperation of all organizations. Without that, it is impossible to come up with any solution, no? Then, of course, what is so important for us is consciousness raising. You know, that's why I put up an Institute of Women's Studies. That Institute of Women's Studies, we give consciousness raising to grassroots women, to religious, all sectors of society. Because I believe that you cannot have a change in any society if we do not have two things. One is change of consciousness, and the other one is change of structure. If you do not have one or the other, then you cannot have a change. But we want a change because there is something wrong with society. So we begin with consciousness raising. We give basic women orientation. We have given this to thousands and thousands of women because we are already 30 years, the Institute of Women's Studies. And we have people from Malaysia. We have people from all parts of Asia. And also because we have what you call intercultural force for women and society. No? And then, of course, gender mainstreaming in academia. Do you know that that is in 2015, the chairperson of the CHED, that is the tertiary education, she was a feminist, and she was able to pass a memorandum that there shall be a gender mainstreaming in all tertiary levels of all schools in the Philippines. You know, we are the only country who has that. And when she went to the United Nations, they gave her a standing ovation. Unfortunately, again, the implementation, you know, because now the head of the CHED, or the one that's responsible for tertiary education, is a man, and certainly not a feminist. So even though there is such a mandate, not many schools are actually implementing it, no? And then legal strategies. Again, we have the best laws for gender-based laws. No, we have Magna Carta for women. We have VAWSI, that means the violence against women in the home. We have against sexual harassment, etc., etc. Again, our problem is implementation and also consciousness raising among those people, among women and among the officers of the local government who are supposed to have this obligation to arrest people and all that. But that's why I'm saying it's important to have good laws, but it's more important to implement them. So, of course, cultural strategies. What we found out in our practice is that drama or play, you know, theater, is one of the most effective consciousness raising means, because when people or students are looking at a play or a theater, they actually internalize, or they have an emotional attachment to the hero or heroine of the play, and therefore the impact on them is greater rather than just to give them seminars. That is only intellectual. But in a play or in a theater, it goes into their psyche. Okay, so culture. And of course, well, of crisis intervention is like Red Cross. So we have, I had found a women crisis center that is what we have, what you call this counseling, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, sometimes one of them would like to sue the husband who is maltreating them. Then we give them help by giving them a free legal service. No? So crisis intervention. Of course, very important solidarity. You know, in the 2001 or 2002, the government said that they are going to make GABRIELA. They were going to say that it is abrogated, etc., because it is subversive. It is like this. Do you know that we got, as a chairperson of GABRIELA, I got 100 letters from 100 organizations all over the Philippines, not only Philippines, but Asia and Europe and all that, and telling the our government, if you abrogate GABRIELA, if you erase them out of existence, we will tell our government not to give you aid, etc. We were never really, GABRIELA was never, abolished by the state, because they saw how much solidarity we have all over the world. No? Now, this is, are just some pictures just to show you, again, mobilization, awakening awareness. This is our Institute of Women's Studies, it's NURSIA, and that is how we do it. These are the inside, and we usually have courses there. And then, of course, the mainstreaming in the academy, as I told you, third number, memorandum number 1, 2015, for all higher education. And we have each university must have what they call God focal point system. The head is the president of the school, but they should have a God committee, and there are four basic function. One is to see to it that all administrative policies should be gender sensitive. In other words, you have to look at the disciplinary, the employment, etc., that it is not discriminating against women. The second is curriculum. Now, this is the more tedious one, because it says that all the disciplines, whether they are natural science, humanities, etc., number one, they should be gender sensitive. But not only that should they be gender sensitive, but they should at least offer one gender course, even as elective or as one of the main subjects. No? And research, all universities have research department. And it says here that one should see to it that all researchers should be gender sensitive. In other words, they should use inclusive language, you know, because it's, as you know, in many universities, the sexist language is in all documents, you know. Even us as sisters, you know, our hymns are very sexist. I remember as sisters, we were singing a song, with God as our father, brothers all are we, let us walk with our brothers. I said, what brothers? We are all women here. How come we are saying, let us walk with our brothers? And I really don't like it when in the sermon of the priest, he says, my dear brothers, let us pray for the salvation of all men. I said, what? Where am I there? You know, I once walked out of a church when the priest was really having a very sexist homily, you know? So that's why we have to be very vigilant, because even the church, most of all, because it's hierarchical also, no? And outreach, all the universities have outreach in poorer communities. We have to see to it that there is a gender sensitivity courses with the women, that the women are also mobilized, that they have income generating projects, and that they are mobilized for women causes. No? So that would be the function of the GAD focal point system in the gender mainstreaming. As you will see there, the legal strategies, H bill, that is the reproductive health bill, there is a paralegal training, there is the Magna Carta for women, etc. And this is what I was telling you, stage play on human trafficking, no? very powerful. And this is our crisis intervention. We have a house called Lila House, Bahay Lila, refuge center. And we include the children with the mothers, and there is counseling, etc. Now, because I am a nun, belong to the church, so I have developed a feminist theology of liberation. That's part of our feminism, no? As religious women, we have to include religion in our what do you call that? In our strategy for change, no? Now, it what means Ecumenical Association of Third World Theologians, and this is international. Our members are from Asia, Africa, Latin America, and what they call this, some parts of the United States. And we are also ecumenical, meaning Catholics and non-Catholics. Now, this ICWAT put up a women's commission in Geneva in 1981, and that is where we developed what we call the women's commission that should bring about what we call a theology of liberation, feminist liberation from the perspective of the third world. And later on, as Asian women, we made it from the perspective of Asian women. And what was the task of the commission? To make a structural analysis of the situation of women, economic, political, social, cultural, and religious, to discuss the patriarchal element in theology today, to reformulate theology from the perspective of the struggle for the full humanity of women. And it developed an Asian feminist theology. And the reason why we said it's necessary is because of the woman question, the fact that there is discrimination, etc. And number two, because religion is used as a socializing force in perpetuating the woman question. I have always to say, as a nun, I have to say to them, religion has two aspects, because it has a divine and a human aspect. Therefore, it has also liberating as well as oppressive aspect. And I give the example. For example, in our Lila house, there was a woman there who was being battered by the husband. And you know what the husband told her? And she was telling this to me. She told the wife, "You woman, do not answer me back, because you are only taken from here." I don't know if you understand what taken from here. That is from the Bible, that Eve is taken from the rib of Adam. You know, now what is funny, not funny, what is ridiculous here is that man is not a theologian. He is not a priest. He is not a religious. But he is using a biblical quotation to rationalize his beating up of the woman. Can you see? And that's why we religious, we have to see that religion is taught properly. Because if it is not taught properly, it can be used, and it is being used to perpetuate the oppression and the subordination of women. Okay. For example, in many, of course, we had many seminars, etc. And I would just like to share with you some of our. Excuse me. I just want to share with you some of our conclusions. In one of our consultation, we said, the oppression of women is sinful. This systemic sin is rooted in organized structures, economic, political, cultural, with patriarchy as an overarching reality that oppresses women. The patriarchal churches have contributed to the subjugation and marginalization of women. Theology itself, in its premise of traditions and beliefs, has blurred the image of God. The bias against women and Christian tradition buttress the male-oriented Asian religious belief. You know, it is very important to analyze all these things, because especially in the Philippines, we are 98% Catholic, and our women are listening to the priests, etc., as if they are spiritual directors. And if they are internalizing that being a secondary citizen, and when there is a trouble in the marital thing, and then the priest will say, "Oh, just be patient, you know, you have to keep your family intact, and therefore you just suffer it." Now, that cannot be, no? I mean, that's why we have to show to them that that is not the correct Christian posture, to just say, "Okay, you can beat me up so that our family will be intact," no? Now, The corollary of this is that the full humanity of women in an authentic and inclusive community of peace, joy, and freedom based on just relationship, we have to affirm that, the full humanity of women. And we connect the women's cause with ecology, ecological, how to call it, advocacy, the integrity of creation, we call that. And then we affirm the feminine creative principle as a life-giving and life-enhancing. And we affirm the prophetic and alternative voice and action of women in liberation movements. And we affirm the solidarity of women among themselves and with others, supporting everyone's struggle as well as the people's movement. Now, one of the most important development, now here I have to tell you that it would take me an hour to explain all this. But what is so important, we found out in our Women's Commission, is that even you have empowered the women economically, politically, socially, if you have not empowered them spiritually, nothing will happen or very little will happen. And so we developed what we call a transforming liberative spirituality. And these are the characteristics. Unfortunately, I can explain to you in 1 hour, but just the characteristic. It has to be a self-affirming spirituality, because we're always denying ourselves as women, individually and communally. No, we have to assert ourselves. It is different from being aggressive. Assertiveness is different from being aggressive. And we have to mutually empower one another. In other words, we should always try to get our fellow women, we have to help them in any endeavor that they have, instead of putting them down like the crab mentality, as it is called, although crabs are not necessarily like that. So our spirituality is developing how we can mutually empower each other. No? And then it is integral. Now, what is the meaning of integral? Because sometimes we dichotomize. This is our prayer. This is our work. This is heaven. This is earth and all that. No, with us, it's all one. No, we feel that you need prayer and you need work together. No, we have a saying, work as if it all depended on you, but pray as if all depended on God. So that is our way of looking at this. And it has to be a liberating spirituality. You know, there are so many slaveries. For example, we said we have to be liberated from three things: from fear, from idols, and from bitterness and resentment. If you are free from idols, fear, and bitterness and resentment, then you are going to be an empowered woman. And then it has to be prophetic. What is prophetic with us? You have to walk your talk. That is, you have to announce the good news, but you have to also to denounce the bad news. In other words, you have to be critical of society, whatever the corruption is. And you have to do it, vocally. What did the prophets do? They stood up and they spoke out. And that is what we consider a prophetic spirituality. We have to stand up and speak out against all forms of corruption or whatever, violence against women. And it has to be contemplative. We say this because lay women, sometimes they're so busy, they do not have time for contemplation, you know, solitude, because that is what makes them really think about themselves in a genuine way, rather than in a very emotional way or so forth. And it is a healing spirituality. What does that mean? We believe in what you call wounded healers. Wherever you are wounded, that is your opportunity to help people who are undergoing the same thing. An example of that is people who are incest victims, they are the best counselors for children who are incest victims. No? And then it is a celebrating spirituality. You know, sometimes we Christians, some of us think that to be holy, you have to have long faces and always sacrificing and all that. No, I said, we are a celebrating spirituality. That means to say that we celebrate everything that happens to our life, whether what you call positive or negative, because the negative can become positive. We have to have joy in our life. And then, you know, when we finish this, actually we had a conference in Huaxtepec, Mexico, where all these women in this committee, we shared with each other what happened to the women we helped to have this spirituality? And because the sharing was so beautiful, we said, we have to write a book. But the book has to summarize this kind of spirituality. And you know what is the title of the book? With Passion and Compassion. Because if you summarize this, it is a passionate and a compassionate spirituality. So appraisal, the end. The women's movement in the Philippines has accomplished much in awakening women awareness of their situation and socialization, in putting the women agenda in government institutions and the NGOs, in having the most women-friendly legislations, in successfully campaigning for the defense of women's rights, Sara Balabagan for Contemplacion, Jennifer Laude, Mary Jane, etc., in making possible that the Philippines is the only country that mandates gender mainstreaming in the academe, and in making possible the prosecution of sex perpetrators against women and children, especially now in cyberbullying. But we are far away from our goal. There is yet no equality in the economic, political, and social sphere, as was said already. Violence against women has not diminished. In fact, in the pandemic, it has increased because the perpetrators and the victims are at home. There is a poor implementation of the laws. And in these 4 years, we have seen the most misogynistic administration in our history. I'm talking about our president, Duterte. He's the most misogynistic president that we ever had in the Philippines, no? So what the women organization are saying, I will say it first in Tagalog, they say, tuloy ang laban, meaning onward with the struggle. And with that, I would like to end my talk. Thank you very much.